Namaskar. Banking has come a long way in the past decade. Services that were considered advanced, like ATM cards, debit cards, credit cards, are now becoming the basic services. Technologies have ventured into the banking in such a way that many branches of the banks have now just converted into humanless banking. Banking has not only entered into new technology, but along with has even entered into a new risk zone. Risk mitigation, legal mitigation, and entrance of various technology has opened various new trends in banking. Today, we have amongst us various experts to discuss trends in banking. At the onset, I would request Ms. Pawandeep Korbendra to kindly share her views in the new trends of banking.
So now we'll discuss about the digital financial literacy initiatives taken up by private sector banks in India. As it was a perception that only public sector bank, they do a good work for the society. But is it a real picture? We need to see this. So as far as in NDLM is concerned, that is National Digital Literacy Mission, which was launched by in 2015 by our Honorable Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi ji, digitalization become part and parcel of our economy. So we can't live without digital apps, as it's a digital era is going on.
Pawandeep ji, I would like to interrupt in between. One question is coming into my mind is that what are the digital literacy financial initiatives taken up by the private sector banks in India?
See, thank you, Bhupal sir. And digital financial literacy is an ability to use effectively digital devices in order to do financial transactions. So I worked, as far as in private sector is concerned, I worked in ICICI for almost 8 years. And what I firmly believe that the bank had taken wonderful digital financial literacy initiatives in order to impart digital literacy among masses. Some of our, like they had adopted villages and converted them into digital literacy villages. So here they teach the villages like how to use the apps, what are the pros and cons of internet banking, mobile banking, etc. In the same way, the bank had partnered with information and communication technology companies in order to teach various digital classes about various digital apps to the masses. The bank had also launched ICICI Customer First series in order to impart digital financial literacy among customers so as to educate them, like not to share CVV, OTP, their ATM pin number, etc. So now we'll look in the initiatives taken up by the Axis Bank. As far as an Axis Bank is concerned, they had already launched a lot of digital financial literacy programs for urban, rural, and semi-urban areas. Some of the programs are like this. They had launched in a partnership with Google. They have launched a Google Online Teach program exclusively for the women for imparting digital financial literacy among them. They have partnered with various NGOs in order to impart digital financial literacy among their customers. HDFC Bank also is very actively participated in these type of the initiatives. They had launched various sustainable livelihood programs to impart the literacy among the masses. And in the same way, they had launched in 2013, there's a program which is called as Dhanchayat. These are basically the video vans that go from village to village areas in order to teach the people about the usage of digital apps, how to use it, and about the issue of the cyber security and etc. So by this we can see whether it's a private sector banks, be it ICICI, Axis, HDFC, these are just some examples. They did a wonderful job as far as in inculcating digital financial literacy among masses, whether through partnerships or through ad campaign. Like now I just remember the example. It's a wonderful ad campaign which was launched by Axis Bank, that is Muh Pe Taala Lagao. It means they had launched exclusively for police, with the help of the police, Mumbai police, like, not to share any type of ATM pin, CVV with the cast, with each other. In the conclusion, I just want to say that we together, all the stakeholders, including public sector banks, private sector banks, state, central, cooperatives, customers, we all have to do a collaborative efforts in order to impart digital financial literacy, which is our vision, mission of India. And with all these collaborative efforts, we are able to make this campaign of Digital India successful in our country.
Thank you, Pawandeep ji. That was a great insight into the digital financial literacy initiatives taken by private sector banks. You were very true in saying that we believe private sector is not doing anything for the society. Your views helped us in understanding a new trend that is setting up in banking. Now, I would request Monika ji to kindly share her views on the new trends in banking.
Thank you, Nistha ji. Now, I would like to talk about payment banks. Payment banks are the latest trends in Indian banking. It has the potential to give wings to the Government of India's most ambitious program, that is financial inclusion. Financial inclusion provides access to financial services, payment and remittances services to the individuals as well as business entities. On the same line, the payment bank has been launched by Reserve Bank of India and recommended by Nachiket Moore Committee. There are certain features of payment bank. First feature is that payment bank can accept deposit of rupees 1 lakh per customer.
They can also provide ATM cards, net banking and checkbook.
They can also provide net banking, mobile banking, and they are also eligible to become the permanent member of clearing house. But as of now, they are not allowed to issue a credit card or a loan. Initially, the payment bank license was given to 11 payment banks, and right now there are 6 payment banks which are working in India. Bharti Airtel Payment Bank was the first payment bank which was launched in March 2017. The license of payment bank was given under Section 22 of the Banking Regulation Act 1949. All the payments banks are working under the strict supervision of Reserve Bank of India. In case of any irregularities found in the functioning of payment bank, Reserve Bank of India take strict action. For example, recently Reserve Bank of India has directed Paytm Payment Bank to stop enrolling new customer because of the non-adherence of KYC norms. On the same line, RBI has also imposed penalty of rupees 5 crore to Airtel Payment Bank because they have not fulfilled the criteria of KYC check.
Monika ji, this makes me a bit inquisitive that when we are having such a robust banking system, where there is requirement for payment banks here?
As per World Bank report, India is a home to 21% world's unbanked adults. Although in India, there is a launch of Jam Trinity, that is Jan Dhan Yojana account, Aadhaar, a digital identity and mobile penetration of more than 80%. But still, there are 37% population who is financially excluded, and those population which is financially included having 21% inactive users. Although our bank has a huge ecosystem, but still it is impossible for banks to open their branches in each and every villages of the country. So, basically, payment banks are going to cater the need of rural people, people of low income household, people who are migrant laborers and the people who are financially excluded. So, main motive of the payment bank launch is, first is financial inclusion, that is to provide financial services, payment and remittances services. Second is penetration of cashless economy, paperless economy and digital economy. And third and most important is elimination of poverty. Yes, some of the success stories tell us that payment bank has led to the elimination of poverty. In Kenya, right now there are 17 million subscribers who are using payment bank, that is M-Pesa. And after using M-Pesa, there is a rise of 5-30% in their household income. The recent transformation is transformation of Indian Postal to Indian Post Payment Bank. Indian Post has 150,000 branches which are catering 89% of the rural areas. So now, after the transformation of post offices into post-payment bank, now the rural people have easy access to financial services. So I can say that payment bank can act as a catalyst for the financial inclusion drive in India.
Thank you, Monika ji. That was indeed a good insight into the payment banking system that has developed in India. Yes, financial inclusion is top online in our Prime Minister's agenda. And thus, having the financial inclusion and payment banks associated with each other helps us in developing fast. Pawandeep ji and Monika ji have shared a very good view about the digital banking initiatives. I would like to add something in case of risk mitigation. Risk mitigation has been a prominent problem in the Indian banking or the world banking industry. Basel Accords have come as an answer to the same. As the world economy are getting closer day by day, the risks are getting affected from one country to another. A problem that is generated in one country has its replicating effects in the economy of the other country and in the banking of the other countries also. Basel Accord, introduced with the Basel 1 norm, have now moved on to their third segment, that is Basel 3. That is the trend in the Indian banking that is now setting in. Basel Accords, an accord that basically deals with credit risk mitigation, an accord that deals with capital adequacy ratio. The three pillars of Basel Accord, that is capital adequacy, supervisory SEPR and market discipline, plays a very prominent role in managing the markets and the banks overall. Capital adequacy, the thing that we all are talking about, the new mergers in the banking system, the new capital infusion in the banking system is all because of the pillar one of the new Basel Accord. The new ratios that are getting introduced into the banking systems are capital conservative ratios, countercyclical buffer ratios, LCFR and NCFR. Along with it, the government has also planned to introduce in last two budgets constant capital of 1,80,000 crores to make the banks more sound.
So, Nistha ji, may I ask you one question, that Basel III will impact banking industry in which manner, and are we really ready for that?
Thank you very much, Pawandeep ji, for this question. Banking in India is very strong, but the only problem that we are facing today is in relation to the capital. We are currently maintaining a rate of 9% capital, while the requirement as per the Basel Accord is 11.5, a tough step to go ahead. But we are in the progress lines. Our government is already participating in the same. Indian banking system has always been a savings economy, and we are strong enough to be dependent on ourselves. The Basel Accords ratios are already being met in the Indian economy. For an example, the Basels have introduced LCR and NCFR. For your information, CRR and SLR are those ratios which are already being helping and maintaining the liquidity into the Indian banking system. So it's not something new that is coming in into the Indian banking. We have already been ready and doing the same since years. Yes, 11.5% is quite a steep task to be achieved. We have seen in past, in last one or couple of years, that we have seen various NPAs coming in. We have to mitigate our risk. While giving credits, we need to be more vigilant. We cannot just now go and give credits to anyone. We have to analyze it in a proper manner. Thus, the new trend says that follow the Basel norms, make the banking strong and move ahead. Till your question is, are we ready? Yes, we are ready. At first, it may prove out to be a bit harder, but it's not that we will not be able to cope up with it. In long run, Basel Accords are something that will help us. SBI, BOB and other private sector banks have shown a dipping trend of NIM in the past years. But let me assure you, a year or two in the capital adequacy maintenance, we will be soon on the upmoving trend. And that can be seen from the recent results of the banks that are coming in. Even the SBI has quoted, last quarter was bad. But now see the results. We are moving towards the positive trend. So yes, we are 100% ready for any movement in the Basel Accord.
Thank you, Nistha ji. Indeed, a very good reply from your side.
We have just seen certain aspects of the banking while discussing financial inclusion, payment banks, and after that, Basel Accords. As we are moving towards the next part, let's discuss about the legal implication. There are certain new trends in the legal market that is affecting the banking industry of India. Bhupal ji, it would be our pleasure to hear from you the new legal trends that are coming in.
Thank you so much, Nistha ji. Plenty of development is taking place in the legal market considering the advancement of technologies. Business system has also, in accordance to the trends of the market, is adopting with the new system. Recently, in the year 2016, a new act has been passed in the name of Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. Since I am from the law background, I feel that I must highlight few of the important judgments which has been passed after passing of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016. Considering Rule 7 of Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016, which states about the time duration within which the matter has to be entertained. Rule says that whenever any application will be filed before the court, it must be entertained within the period of 14 days, else it must be refused. Now, simultaneously, under Order 8, Rule 1 of CPC, which states that if any kind of situation arises, the time duration can be enhanced. Now, the question arises that in CPC, which provides more duration, whereas IBC only provides 14 days of time. So, whether there is any kind of implication of Code of Civil Procedure over Insolvency Code. In this regard, one appeal has been filed before NCLAT in JK Jute Mills case. The court has come out with the rule that yes, when there is any kind of exceptional hardship, we can extend the time subject to the condition that the reasons must be recorded down. Plenty of development is taking place in the legal market considering the advancements of technologies. Because of the change in the trends of business system, recently in the year 2016, a new code has been passed in the name of Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016. Since I am from law background, I feel that I must highlight few of the important judgments which has been pronounced after the passing of Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016. Rule 7 of Insolvency Code, which states that within the period of 14 days, if any application has been filed, it either must be entertained or it must be rejected. Simultaneously, if I can quote Order 8, Rule 1 of CPC, which states that if there is any exceptional hardship, time duration can be enhanced. Now, the thing is that whether there is any kind of implication of Code of Civil Procedure over Insolvency Code. This matter has been filed before the NCLT court in the name of JK Jute Mill case. In that case, court has come out with a new rule which states that if the court finds that there is any exceptional hardship, by recording down the sufficient reasons, it can enhance the time duration of 14 days. Moving further to Rule 8, which states withdrawal of application. Rule 8 only states that if any application which has been previously filed before any court, it can be withdrawn prior to its admission. Now, the question arises if the parties to the dispute amicably settles this matter after going to the court, whether court is left with any kind of issues to address with. In the matter of Lokandwala Kataria construction case, the matter has been filed before NCLT. Subsequently, parties have moved to NCLAT with the petition by invoking the jurisdiction and the name of inherent power of the court under Rule 8, court must dismiss the petition, must allow the parties to withdraw that petition. NCLAT has found that since in the court there is no such provision for withdrawal of the petition after it is entertained, accordingly, the court has found that since there is no sufficient provision is there in IBC code, that's why court has not entertained that petition. Getting aggrieved against that order, parties have moved to the Supreme Court of India under Article 142 of the Constitution. Supreme Court of India, after getting that petition, has come out with the conclusion that NCLAT has rightly dismissed the petition, but exercising the inherent power of Supreme Court of India, it has allowed the parties to settle up this matter with a declaration that they must comply with the consent order.
Bhupalji, sorry to interrupt you. As you are referring the case, I would like to ask a question. Whether certificate from financial institution is mandatory before filing an application?
Very interesting question you have asked, Monika ji. Rule 9 of the code states that if any person intends to file an application before the court, it must be accompanied with a certificate obtained from financial institution. Now the question arises, if any banking institution does not provide any certificate, then what will be the position in this regard? Simultaneously, in one case named as Macquarie Bank Limited case, in that one, this matter has been filed before Supreme Court of India. Supreme Court of India has considered that if any foreign person intends to file an application before the court, then there will be less chance for obtaining that kind of certificate from the financial institution. Section 9 further states that the certificate from the banking institution must be obtained from those banks which has been opened or which is operating within the territory of India. So likewise, there is less chance for obtaining a certificate from the foreign one, or that kind of certificate is usually not given to the foreigner. So, Supreme Court has interpreted Section 9 in a different direction, stating that this will be considered only as a piece of evidence. So, if you have got any kind of certificate, it can only be considered as evidence. Otherwise, you can directly move to the Supreme Court or any of the court competent to entertain this petition.
Thank you, Bhupalji. What an interesting thing to be seen, that the trends have not only changed in the banking sector, the legal sector is also coming up with the norms that helps the banking sector in meeting the new trends. We have just seen and heard from the experts' views about financial inclusion, digital financial literacy, payment banks, Basel norms, and finally, the Indian Bankruptcy Code. Together, we can and we will make the Indian banking more stronger and ways to go. Thank you.